The Indian Machine Tool Manufacturers Association, IMTMA, providing the cutting edge to India's machine tool industry. IMTMA was formed in 1946 with a vision of providing a one-stop impetus for the machine tool industry in India, spearheading India into the forefront of industrial revolution by providing a platform for symbiotic industry growth and innovation-led machine tool technologies. What's more, IMTMA has today become a center of excellence for focused application-based training.
This program will be facilitated by Mr. Ramadas Arnambi. Mr. Ramadas Arnambi is an industry expert with over 30 years of experience in the area of CNC control systems, CNC machines, industrial robots and unmanned operation. Presentations will be accompanied by practical demonstrations and case studies. The workshop will be highly interactive where participants will be able to discuss specific problems in maintenance and solicit feedback from the expert faculty.
It's a pleasure to be with you today and share my knowledge earned, learned, enhanced through this 30 and odd years exposure to the industry. The topic is quite interesting one. Zero downtime, that means literally no breakdown. Is it possible? It's a very challenging scenario. So what is required towards achieving that? I use the word towards achieving that. So there are many things are required. One such area, contribution from many people, many departments, and directly this is related to the maintenance team member. To what extent they can. All along, the maintenance department in various industry is really rich, no matter whether they are in which category of company, small, medium, and large, huge sector company. There is a compartments available like mechanical department, electrical department, electronics department, and so on. So when it comes to resolving issue and make the machine available for the higher productivity within the company so that the OEE is maximum possible with the lesser downtime, and get the higher productivity, and so on. The current attitude and approach of each member within the maintenance department, no matter they are from what level, should have an overall knowledge about the clients or the machines, which I name it as a patients, because all these members in maintenance department are doctor for machines. They are forgetting that main important aspect. They are doctor for the machine. So the doctor is supposed to have a wider knowledge about all section of the machine, every individual parts in the machine, if not in depth, if not in detail, at least a fair amount of knowledge is required. Do we have that? Most of the time, the answer is, no, I'm from electrical, I know this much. The other one, the mechanical team takes care of it. The electronics team takes care of it, you know, passing on the buck to somebody else, except for some companies, some people, there are many people rather, who take one step forward and try to be good in everything. In addition to what they are specialized, that they'll be a champion in it. So today, approach is required. First thing, before even I could open the slide, we need to remove the rigid defense put across the individual team section within the maintenance to throw it out. And everybody should feel that I'm a good mechanical engineer, I'm a good electronics engineer, I'm a good hydraulic engineer, and so on. How is it possible? Well, one has to enhance the knowledge, get opportunity to get trained through the workshop and various training, and acquire knowledge and come up to that. The electrical guy should have a thorough knowledge in hydraulics, pneumatics, lubrication, and mechanical elements. And the tooling knowledge. He is not a production engineer. But then he should have a fair amount of a limited knowledge towards that. Then only one can correlate and understand while solving the issue. For example, the current scenario of today. Let me go to the slide number one. Here you see a green leaf. Actually, it is a gray color. The person is taking a painting brush and trying to give a green finish touch to that to bury the problem, cover up the problem, hide the problem underneath the carpet. Why? To project it, everything is good, good. No. Instead of doing this green painting on top of the gray leaf, identify, get to the root cause. What could be the problem? To get to the root cause on a simple tree leaf, what do you need? Do you need some knowledge? Yes, of course. You need to know what makes the green color comes there. Sunlight is required. More important, the tree itself through the root have to get the water, the nutrition aspect from the soil, etc., etc. Without that, having a multiple input to get the green color, identify one by one and locate the area where it is a defective and correct it, and it becomes a green. So one should have good understanding of everything related to the tree or the problem, and its functioning knowledge is very much essential. So without that, it's difficult to go and get the root cause. Unless the person identifies the root cause, try to give a solution that could be a permanent in nature and a learning, so that next time that can be included in the preventive maintenance or a predictive maintenance, so that no opportunity comes for a breakdown scenario while production is in good swing of going. So it is a continuous PDCA, you can call it, or you understand, get the root cause and try to prevent it, reoccurrence, and so on. So the requirement is get to the root cause, number one. Number two, be good in everything related to the CNC machine, no matter your electrical, electronics, mechanical, production, whatever it is. But you should know everything and to do this. That means everybody has got a lighter or more information in the level of surface level. You know all the words of it, but you don't know the in-depth level. No need to go in-depth, at least go 1 meter, 2 meter above the surface level. Try to see what that activity needs, how it is performing, what is the functioning, major root cause could be what, no idea. And all the maintenance member, as I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, They're all the doctors for CNC machine from today. If that is the case, is this doctors have got a sufficient knowledge about the machine? For example, forget the machine for a while. Let us come to our own body. Do we know what is inside our body? If somebody asks, I will not show this as my eyes because it's externally visible, right? Likewise, if I ask where is my internal organ located, how many of us are ready to answer? Example, now here is the screen showing a person with the navel point around the cursor where I'm moving. Let me try to put a box 1 to 9. So the each box has got a 1, 2, 3, 9. Please identify your stomach location in your body for the past 20 years or 30 years or 40, 50, 60, 70 years. You know what is the real answer? Answer is number 3. So to that extent, we guys are ignorant. So when I said number 3, everybody will be doubting just below, you know, look at my image. So it is just below your nipple on the left-hand side. I will give you a more better view now. Yes, this is where the stomach is located. And look at the navel point. So we are not aware about our own health, our own maintenance. Then how can be a good doctor for the machine? Some people may be saying, sorry, you must be giving a wrong picture. The reality is different. Yes, you have the right to say that. Because whenever you learn something, it is our duty to cross-check, validate before you accept the right answer. For such people, I'm going to play in video now, where the doctors in Germany, they have the dead body, live body to teach the medical students anatomy of a human body. So this anatomy gives you a better understanding that this is where the stomach, whatever you eat is coming here, getting processed for 2.5 hours, then they are going to smaller intestine. This is an internal. You can convert this as a, where is the lubrication pump? Where is the hydraulic pump? Where is the Z-axis motor? Where is the X-axis motor? Are we knowledgeable? Maybe not. But our own body, 20 years or 30, 40, 50 years, we don't know where is our stomach. Otherwise, we are totally no knowledge. Okay, like this, it's high time for us to know who are we. So let us remove the skin, remove the bones, and that's it. So this is how the air pipe, trachea is coming, going to the left and right. The food pipe is coming to the stomach. And thereafter, how they are getting processed. Now, this is the cross-sectional view of it. And there is a diaphragm, which is separating the lungs and heart to the stomach area, abdomen area. I'm going to remove them. Yes. This is the liver organ on the right side. Left side is the stomach. Adjacent to the stomach, you have a spleen. You have a larger intestine starting from here to here. You have a smaller intestine. Those who declared 5, 6, 8, this is the location you declared as a stomach. They are the location of smaller intestine, 22 feet in length for male, 23 feet in length for the female, 1-inch tube. So that end is getting connected and it's going and it's coming through. And as well, this kind of knowledge is required. Now let me play the video and try to show the backside. So you have two kidneys right behind the stomach, right kidney. No, it's a left kidney. And this one is a right kidney. Both the kidney have got a 2-cap. They are nothing but an adrenal gland. And the tube is coming. It's going to urinary bladder. Right behind the stomach, let me go a little closer to the stomach. Yes, this is the pancreas. behind it, and so on. So now, the liver is here. Underneath the liver, see the green color bag, that is nothing but a gallbladder. So I'm going to remove the liver organ and the gallbladder, which is not directly connected, and the spleen also. Now the food is coming here and getting processed and going. Such a knowledge on the human body itself, we don't have an idea. They are coming from the mouth to here and then going 22-23 feet, then coming down here and going up, going across, going down, and finally they are coming out as a undigested stool, as a waste of product, which we pass it on as a stool in the next day. So this is the system. Like this, these maintenance doctors should know the machine in and out. Are we having a sufficient knowledge on that aspect? Unfortunately, no. Every time we try to pass on the other's area, it's, you know, it's a mechanical job there. Mechanical team takes care of it. Electrical takes care of it. Electronics takes care of it. I don't know about it. We should not be saying that. We should participate in learning another thing. That is precisely is a knowledge enhancement through the training and workshop. Then wonderful things can be achieved, which in turn will support you to reduce the downtime. Reduction of downtime is your approaching towards the zero downtime. As it progress, and then a day will come, you'll be totally able to achieve your zero downtime only during production hours. Non-production hours, yeah, everybody needs a maintenance, including human body. Machine also needs a maintenance. But that is done in a kind of a preventive maintenance during the non-productive time. Week off, or once or twice in a year, or 1 week closure. So while everything is getting back to normalized, so that zero downtime is possible. Right, with this background, understanding that we need to enhance our knowledge to achieve so many things. What is exactly the zero downtime achievement is required? Number one, training to enhance the knowledge. No, if we are all having a good knowledge, but then we need to enhance our skill and additional knowledge in all levels through the training and the workshops. Once you know in and out, like we saw the human body just now, once you know in and out of all components, all internal elements used within the CNC machine, you will be able to come out with a very good understanding of anatomy of a CNC machine. Once you know the good knowledge, anatomy of a CNC machine, then you will come out with the effective preventive maintenance schedule, because you know which one needs what time. Because their lifetime, within the lifespan time, you need to start rectifying certain replacement something, plan it so that they never go into the breakdown scenario. You can also do a predictive maintenance on a live condition. Using the screen available on the CNC system, you'll be able to predict it if you're closer to the machine. If you are staying away and you're controlling from your chamber, you'll be using a IoT, today's fourth generation. Health status of every machine is available right on a click of a button on your screen. Try to see the performance, the way they are performing. Once you know the curve is going towards the breakdown, time to declare some preventive maintenance based on the predictive maintenance, so that they are executed during a non-productive hours, so the breakdown is fully avoided. So major thing is coming to anatomy of a CNC machine. That is not an easy thing, because electrical guys should know mechanical and other stuffs in addition to the electrical stuff, and vice versa for the mechanical person, and so on. So after predictive maintenance, what else you need to have? Prevent the breakdown maintenance during the production hours. I repeat, during the production hours. You can't prevent it totally. So how to prevent this? Through the preventive maintenance and the predictive maintenance. Then if you are effective on these two, then the prevention of breakdown during the production hours is prevented. Then comes, you need to have a good skill, good knowledge. The team is superbly functioning after understanding the anatomy of CNC machine and the approach, new strategy, new style, because every engineer is electrical, electronics, mechanical, production, hydraulic, all aspect. So they'll be able to bring down the MTTR, mean time to repair, reduce MTTR. During when? When you are doing a breakdown maintenance during a non-productive hours, you cannot take 1 day, 2 day, 3 day. You should come in number of hours to solve the issues and put back in operation. So anything you predict how to bring it back to normalcy is MTTR. And over and above this, with the background of this knowledge and the experience and exposure, the entire maintenance team from the top to the operator or the fitter or a technician level will be having a saying of selection of machine. What does it bring into? One has to choose a high MTBF machine. What is MTBF? Mean time between failure. So if you are procuring a CNC machine which has got a lesser MTBF, frequent failures, then your zero downtime is not possible. You need to change over to procure or improve existing machine by proper upgrading the new existing system with the newer system and newer technology by investing lesser amount than a full amount of machine investment and bring back. Again, this needs a different level of knowledge, something like a machine tool building division knowledge. So the maintenance team have to be given their clear oath to select an appropriate suitable machine for your shop floor. So with all these conditions, what we have gone through can help you to march towards the zero downtime, and you will achieve it as you fully get all these items in place. It takes time. Okay, we will review this after I start my next slide now. I'm getting into the topic of anatomy of a CNC machine. Now, anatomy of a CNC machine means what? What exactly you need to do? Well, we will take the major elements, which are present in CNC machine. What are the major elements? I would say there are about six major, doesn't mean only six, six major elements. Now, CNC control system is number one element. Then who is number two? Naturally, the mechanical elements. And who is number three? The electrical. Who is number four? Hydraulic. Number five, pneumatic. And number six, the lubrication. So are they limited to six? No, there are many. But are you good in number one? Are you good in number two? Are you good in number three? If you ask a question, sometime we will end up like identifying the stomach location. Similar experience. So from the surface level knowledge, we need to enhance our knowledge in depth level in each category. No matter you belong to electrical, mechanical, hydraulic, you may be electronics, you should know this. You may be electrical, you should know the hydraulic. Then only you will be a good doctor to treat the patient, so-called CNC machine. Okay, so with this background, let us go to number one. So anatomy of a CNC control system. When you take any chapter, any subject of learning, don't be in a surface level. You need to know the history, how they are evaluated, since how long the CNC emissions are present in the global scenario, forget Indian scenario. Is it 100 years or 200 years or 300 years? We don't know, but we must know, because that is the clientele or the patient level we are going to handle. Are they 40 years old technology? Are they 200 years old technologies? Don't know. So start with the relay logic machine. We didn't have the machine in the beginning, right? So the relay logic machine, then we moved to hardwired machine, then to programmable logic controller, PLC based machine, then to numerical control machine. What is that numerical control? Those days, the computer used to have a lesser RAM memory. They are in bytes, not even in kilobytes. Then the KB came, then the MB came. Now we are running in GB and TB, terabyte, gigabyte, terabyte. So after the numerical control, the computerized numerical control machine has evolved. This is how the CNC machine coming into place. So concept of CNC technology. Why do you say CNC? Computer numerical control. So everybody knows, I'm sure all of you present here, all literally are knowledgeable people. But then we need to get into the basic fundamentals. We should never miss the basic fundamental. Without the foundation, good, stronger foundation, can I build the 20th floor in an apartment? Without the support of floor one, floor ground, floor foundation, likewise, we need to know that. So this is a dedicated computer. CNC is nothing but a dedicated computer to control the machine tool in the area of, number one, input and output signal. Number two, the display and the machine control panel, servo and spindle motor through the drive controller, automatic tool changer, automatic pallet changer, turret, index table, etc., etc. So for this purpose, how does the computer works? That is the basic fundamental. You have a CPU, central processing unit. To that, you're giving an input to get an output. Is it the same structure in which CNC is working? Of course, CNC is also a computer. If this is a block diagram of a computer, CNC is no exception. So let me try to give a view of it. Now, CNC on the left side, you have a machine input as one of the input. You have the axis motor and spindle motor, rotary, pulse coder, input as an input, and output towards the machine output in the form of solenoid or indication lamp, etc. Output in the form of command voltage going to the servo axis drive or a spindle drive, etc. So broadly, these are the four categories available in your CNC machine. Out of the four categories, the top two, I would like to separate it as an area one, and the bottom two as an area two. Why there's such a difference? Area one is a simple job, something to turn it on and turn it off. It's like an on-off business. Whereas area two is a continuously driving and monitoring and driving. It's like, you know, when you're sitting on a bike and going, you need to see the road. When a curvature comes, you start tilting yourself to take the curve. Don't be rigid and you'll end up in falling down on the corner of the road while taking the corner turning. Likewise, ongoing, real-time basis. So this is a continuous monitoring type. This is a one-time on-off business, either one or zero, on or off business. So are they into computer basics? Yes, very much. Input, which are the input? Machine input and pulse coder. Which are the output? The machine output, operator panel, LED lamp, solenoid coil, command to the spindle, command to the servo drive, X-axis, Y-axis, Z-axis, and so on. Now, I'm going to introduce a new guy here called PLC. In Fanuc, they call it slightly different. PMC, Programmable Machine Controller in place of Programmable Logic Controller. So I'm putting both the name here. So you have an input. What are the input possible? Switches, push button, foot switch, pressure switch, proximity switch, etc., etc. What are the output is possible? Relay coil, contactor coil, indication lamp, and MOP and MCP, machine operator panel or a machine control panel, which has got a many input as well as they take the output for indication lamps. So all these item is controlled by the programming logic control like a manager and reporting to a general manager, CNC. So the responsibility of this manager, so-called PLC, have to manage one and on and off business of the machine. Keep informing what is happening. If big boss is saying something, stop it means spontaneously you stop them. So this is one area of operation, area one. And area two is the servo motor area. That's all the CNC machine. This is the basic fundamental. If you're good in area one and area two, you're good in CNC machine. Simple. Now, coming to the control and servo history, if you look back, there was no control available until 1949. It was only manpower doing the work. From 49, we had a relay logic sequence, relay sequence to move something forward and thing in a step by step. Then came the TTL level, transistor logic, to move the control. In 1972, you had the microcomputer, microprocessor. So then they started the PLC, CNC, and going on. Since 1994, you have a DSP. The DSP is here, it's not a deputy superintendent of police. It is digital signal processing technology. With that, artificial intelligence function was adopted. And it's going through on it continuously. So as for the control, literally, this is the area, relay logic and a transistor logic. The relay time was using a transistor, which is a valve type transistor, then to semiconductor type, then into microprocessor and so on. How about the servo motor? No motors were available in 1952. We had a fully controlled, that is electric, hydraulic, pulse motor. You have a hydraulic, you have a pulsing and electric. Can you see the picture on the left side, top corner? This is how the servo motor looks like. Versus the today's right side, the servo motor, digital servo motor here. How was the migration from electric? In 1970, we had a DC servo motor. In 1982, we had an AC analog servo motor. In 1984, we had an AC digital servo. And it's still going on. In 1994, we had a linear servo motor introduction, technology-wise. So using the rotary servo motor and the linear servo motor, the machine is working today. That's all. So what are we talking from 2020 to backward? Even if I take it 1956 or 50, how many years? It's only 70-year-old technology. I'm giving you two people, the leading people in industry, Siemens history. They started development in 1960 in the name of Sinemary. And they came out a system, and today they are known as Sinemaric CNC system. Likewise, the Phonak system. 1956, the first numerical control made available. First commercial was given to 1958 from Phonak to Makino. And 1959, the first continuous path manufacturing was available using the first electro-hydraulic pulse motor. That's how the history goes. And today what is available? It's all digital servo motor, digital spindle motor, with the linear or with the rotary, with the digital signal processing, with the artificial intelligence function, so-called AI function, and so on. So history is over. Who is CNC is known. How many years is popular is also known. Now time to see the major elements like this. I'm not going to take the full class here. To the master PCB or the motherboard or a CNC or a CPU, you're connecting the power supply, you're connecting the LCD, LED display controller, which is coming and displaying here. By the side of that, you have the keyboard called as a MDI. The keyboard is connected through the MDI keyboard control to here, and so on. And it's coming to the memory area. So all this is available and controlled through the memory bank, operating system, executive EEPROMs, PLC EEPROMs, and so on. External communication through the personal computer or a tape reader, hard disk drive, pen drive, or to the LAN through the Ethernet connectivity with the built-in or built external PLC, etc. So all this is working on what principle? Three word, NONC coil. NO is normally open, NC normally closed, and a coil, that's all. If you put all the three, entire ladder diagram is finished. The basic fundamental is NONC and relay or a coil. So the symbolically, in an off condition and on condition, two line and a cross line indicating normally closed. That means when the power is off, they are normally open and normally closed. When the power is on, the NC remains as the NC. They don't become NO. Only thing they get open, NO is getting closed. That means this is a one status, and that's the other one is a zero status. So as you see here, this NO getting closed, when it is activated, they become a one status and zero. One and zero is controlled by the area one, and the CNC is controlling how to, when to turn on, at what condition to turn on this coil is given as a condition in the ladder diagram. Accordingly, they are monitored through the ladder diagram. So you have a three major area, CNC area, PLC area, and a machine tool area. So the information, NONC is coming into here as an X address in terms of FANUC is concerned, and Y address is an output. And from here to here, we have a G address and F address coming back. Internally within the PLC or PMC, you're using R relay, C for counter, T for timer, D for data table, K for keep relay, and so on. In a block diagram wise, this is how they are communicating. In terms of FANUC, in terms of Siemens, it's different. This is how the ladder diagram is appearing. In place of X, European style, I is an input, Q is an output. The one going to CNC coming is a V signal in the past, currently DB signal. How to differentiate the DB? The first two digits happen to be an even address, then it's a PLC to CNC. If it is an odd address, then CNC to PLC. All this knowledge you need to have an idea. The basic fundamental. Now, how the axis is connected, how the spindle is connected. First, the axis. So axis is connected through the servo drive, through the card. Drive is here, motor is here, pulse coder is coming and being processed and going. For a DC analog servo motor, how is it connected? AC analog, how is it connected? What are the elements? How the motor construction looks like and the knowledge. You know, every bit of internal information is required. Then comes the digital servo motor, digital serial communication to the amplifier and get the things done. Or reduce the number of wires through the optical communication. Two wires, optical, communicating entire things. So lesser the number of elements with the servo motor and amplifier. And as a spindle drive controller and feedback processor and an amplifier for that, and the spindle motor, DC technology, AC analog technology, and AC digital technology. So in digital, either serial wire or an optical wire is used for a communication. All the wires are reduced to two wire system. Entire thing is getting connected. Finally, the CNC, which is right behind the LCD screen, about 60 to 70 mm projection in the backside, is getting connected to the amplifier area, servo and spindle, which is getting connected to the machine. And the machine start performing, right? In place of manual handle rotating like this. So servo motors are used, which in turn is driven by the servo motor to the ball screw. So entirely replacing a conventional to a ball screw. End of the ball screw, connect a servo motor like this. The CNC, whatever we are inputting is visible in the screen, is commanding to the amplifier. Amplifier is rotating and getting the motor, whichever area you want, and getting the complete machine with the multiple pallets you'll be able to get the multiple pallets working and the X and Y, Z axis on a horizontal machining center is working for you. Get things done and get the tool changed automatically, get the pallet changed automatically. Everything happens. All are controlled by what? A simple computer. So that is the area one of operation. How about area two? Is also over, servo drive. Area one is a PLC, ladder diagram, and area two, with this combination, we have done the study on it. Now, the entire system, if I take a Phonak system, how the system is connected through the fiber optical wire called as a Phonak servo serial bus and the IO link network to the motor, how they are connected with a two channel or a two path. Likewise, the Siemens system, how they are connected to the PCU for the 802 system, where are the IO card, where are the servo drive cards, how they are connected. Each element, the connector name to everything, one has to be familiar. As a doctor, I should know which connector means what. So all such is known as here is available. I'm not going through that. So this is what one has to be enhanced with the knowledge. So anytime they are asked to look at that system, they should know this basic fundamental information. Overall 8-to-8 system, 840 system, and where 840 is used, where 8-to-8 is used, where 808 is used. Why? Because of number of access, etc. All that knowledge is essential. As a doctor of machine, as a maintenance member, I'm from today is called as a doctor. Okay, once they are in a place, then the automatic environment can come in and work like this. Which can give you the 24 hours continuous working, 1 month production continuously working. All right. So the chapter two is mechanical element. So what is there to know? Basic fundamental, come to the basic fundamental, how the machines are categorized. You have a lathe, which is the predominant CNC turning lathe or a turning center. Globally, 60 to 70% are the turning machines. Close to 15 to 20% is a machining center and the grinding machine and thereafter the other machining. So in the machining center, if I take it, how do you categorize them? By the number of axis classification, with the vertical or horizontal, with the tool, without tool, with the pallet changer, without pallet changer, etc. Try to get the knowledge. How do they look like? Why they are called so horizontal and vertical? How does the tool changes happening? What kind of a different types available? All knowledge is essential. So generally when you walk as a maintenance man, you start scratching your head and then you'll become bald because lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge of what? Many things. As a machine process, we don't know nothing. We think that that is job of production people, industrial engineering people. Why should I know? No, you should know. One has to know basic machining practice, tooling knowledge. How many drill type tools are available? One or two, but actually there are many drill type tools like this to make a hole. So which tool is used for what is the knowledge is required? How many milling cutters are available? Too many. So like this, you know, the very primitive and the basic fundamentals. Then come to the machine configuration, C-frame, gantry type, HMC, horizontal machining center, or a VMC with the gantry type, VMC with the C-frame type, etc. So what exactly are you looking into that? So just trying to see how the bed is formed. On top of bed, which gateways is there? On that column is coming, which gateways is there? Headstock is coming inside that spindle. This is the C shape. That's why we call it as a C frame, etc., etc. The bed, saddle, table, attaching the tool changer and the table indexer or the rotary table. So horizontal machining center, likewise, similar way. I'm skipping. Direction of motion is very important. Most of the time you go as a maintenance guy, end up moving the machine, end up in accident. Thereafter, we have a fear not to touch the machine. Ask the operator or a production engineer to do it. Can you move this, that day, this side? Why? We should be a good operator as well. If you're a doctor, you should be a good operator as well. So you should operate the machine for which the direction all required. You should not be scratching which X plus X minus direction. Is it with relevant to the tool tip or relevant to the job or the datum point of the job or the machine datum? All scratching happens. That should not be the case. So you should be able to know which axis is what. Likewise, the Gantt style vertical machining center. Likewise, the horizontal machining center. So through the video during this course, we'll be going through the olden days machine process, how they work, like a crash course in milling machine. So basic machine anatomy. After that, migrate them into a CNC machine. All the, there are about 9 videos covering up to almost close to half an hour video playing. Some of the videos here, some of the universal machining center apart from the horizontal and vertical. Likewise, the turning centers. Likewise, the turning center category, namely the straight bed, slant bed, and vertical. How they look like, what are the, you know, the internal elements as a naked machine during the process of assembly, how they look like. Such things have to be understood either a factory visit or through the video learning so that your machine can be visualized. So this brings us a kind of a mechanical element, quick, brief, rush through rather. Then I'm going into electrical circuit diagram. This is very, very important, you know. There is no fixed hard and fast rule available how exactly one has to present the electrical circuit diagram. Everybody has got their own style of electrical manual, circuit diagram manual presenting. So here, during this class, the virtual training or a class workshop training, sample 1, sample 2, sample 3, sample 4 will be taken. Go in depth, find the difference. End of the day, what is the structure and pattern this circuit diagram is following? What is the structure and this circuit diagram is following? Then the third one and the fourth one. Then you become a champion. Oh my goodness. Electrical circuit diagram means they should have a title page followed by a index page, followed by a block diagram, followed by a electrical circuit diagram, followed by a IO listing, followed by what all. That kind of idea you'll get it so that one can, with the background knowledge, go to any machine circuit diagram within 5 to 10 minutes, you'll become good at it and start attending to the machine problem. Rather than currently, you don't know how to read the electrical circuit diagram, you don't even use the circuit diagram. With the knowledge, we try to manage, somehow cover up, put back the machine in operation in a proper or improper way and hand it over to the production. Because of such kind of cover-up activity, something big is going to happen, big blow is going to happen, which will involve big investment of money and loss of time due to lack of knowledge and approach and solving from the root cause. So electrical circuit diagram is very important. Hydraulic circuit diagram, it's a very simple one, as long as you learn it. Pick up, especially for the electrical guys, non-mechanical. So how to do that? Have some simulation circuits. So how things work? Okay, once you change it, how the pressure point is going to be, A to the tank. Likewise, how the pressure is now going to change. P is coming to A and B is going to the tank and so on. And there are many methods, symbols used in the circuit diagram. Educate them. Likewise, hydraulic and pneumatic is the same. Only difference is what? Hydraulic oil is used here, pneumatic air is used. Hydraulic oil being a costly, I have to return to the tank. Pneumatic air does not return to the compressor room. It is escaped right near the machine through the silencer like a psh, psh. But rest of the elements used in hydraulic and pneumatic are common. So once you know the hydraulic, how to read it and do it, same thing here. Come to the lubrication. So how to be effective? So very simple. Each axis needs only 5 points distribution. Which are the 5 points? Two, I will take this x-axis. First two is for the right side or left side of the gateways. Second two for the right and left side of the gateways. And the third one is for the ball nut. Through the metering cartridge, how much oil to go. Through the distribution manifold. So from the pump, distribute one to the manifold, x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, job is over. Simple. It's hardly a 10 to 20 minute study. Instead of keeping it away, understand how does the metering cartridge work, how this is working, and go and see in the machine how it works. So electrical engineer is also a mechanical engineer now. Like this, educate in each and every aspect in the machine. Within the pump, what is available, how the pump is sucking, how it is going, what is the float switch role to indicate the low level of the oil available, how the same DCV, direction control valve, is used. Is the pressure is coming or not? Pressure switch is giving an indication, and a manual machine, and is distributing, and so on. Read it, the basic fundamentals. Once you have all that, then with the enhanced knowledge, after the so-called 2 days or 3 days, it will be soon decided. One will become a good anatomy knowledge related to machine. As a result, one can plan effective preventive maintenance. One can start using the predictive maintenance to stop the breakdown. So totally march towards preventing breakdown during production hours. Non-production hours, try to reduce the MTTR, mean time to repair. Also, with all the knowledge above, next time when you select a machine or existing machine, you convert it to a better or higher MTBF, mean time between failure performance. So this is what is required, marching towards the zero downtime. So it's a slow handholding and enhancing the knowledge, march towards that ZTT, it is possible to get zero downtime. It's only how effectively you implement this background. This is only a bullet point, not limited to this. There are more things are available.